When memorable periods in American history are remembered, the decade of the 1950s has to be included. It was a time in which the majority of Americans enjoyed unprecedented peace and prosperity. World War II and the Korean War had ended, and for a time the clouds of war were nowhere to be seen. As the country grew and prospered, a new spirit of youthful exuberance and freedom also emerged. Given birth by rock and roll, it captured America's youth like nothing else ever had. The mellow melodies and slow rhythms of Glenn Miller were replaced by the driving beat of songs from Elvis Presley, Little Richard, and Bill Haley and the Comets. Try to save, heart says go, go. Have a time for the Saturday night, and baby, how I feel fine. I'm gonna rock it up. I'm gonna rip it up. The 1950s were called the decade of prosperity. Economic growth in the U.S. hit amazing new heights. Our economic future looked very bright indeed, and it was during this rather idyllic time that we all made personal decisions about attending West Point. Some of us would choose West Point to fulfill a lifelong desire to pursue a military career. For others, it was for a free education, or to follow a family tradition, or simply for the prestige, challenge, and quality of education that West Point provided. Most of us were fresh out of high school, but many had attended prep schools or other colleges, including military schools like VMI and the Citadel. There were various ways to receive a nomination to West Point, but the majority of us received congressional nominations through the principal and alternate systems, and approximately 120 received nominations as distinguished military graduates of honor military schools. Everyone nominated through this process was directed to report in March of 1956 to one of 24 military installations worldwide to undergo medical, physical, and the math and English scholastic aptitude tests in order to compete for an actual appointment to the academy. Only about 10% of all nominees made it through this process and were offered an appointment. A total of 756 nominees accepted their appointments and reported to West Point on July 3rd, 1956.
Each year, from every state in the Union, a group of young men travels across the continent to enroll at a great educational institution, a school that has given to the nation some of its outstanding leaders. Leaders like Dwight D. Eisenhower, Douglas MacArthur, and John J. Pershing. To get to this school, these young men converge on a place about 50 miles north of New York City, a place known as West Point, the United States Military Academy. Time-honored, world-renowned, filled with great traditions, with roots in the very heart of America. This is West Point.
Some arrived at West Point by car and bus, but most of us came by train. As we followed the man in the red sash up the hill from the train station, we had little or no idea of what was in store. Once we entered the West Academic Building, we would no longer be in control of our own lives. We were starting down the path of leaving civilian life, habits, and individual egos behind, and learning how to become soldiers, classmates, and members of a single team with a common purpose: the defense of our country. For most of us, that first day was an absolute blur. After completing a stack of registration forms and receiving one last physical exam, a booklet was attached to our belt. It was a checklist to keep track of all the items that we would be issued during the rest of the day. We were ushered out into central area and formed up in two ranks. As one of the first squad leaders was heard to say, "All right, gentlemen, now the fun begins." And he wasn't kidding. The very first thing we learned was how to stand at attention and brace. The second was that our only responses were, yes, sir, no, sir, and no excuse, sir. Next came saluting, facing movements, marching, and column movements. We also learned that in no uncertain terms, drop that bag really meant release it now, no matter what its contents were or how fragile they might be. We were assigned to one of six new cadet companies according to our height. And who can ever forget stepping up exactly to that line and saying, sir, new cadet Smith reports to the first sergeant of 5th new cadet company for the 7th time as ordered. What a relief it was when we finally got it right. Few will forget getting their first West Point haircut. Just a little off the top, please, we asked. Sure thing, said the barber, and just 30 seconds later, all that hair that was our high school pride and glory lay in a heap on the floor, a symbol of our first lesson in humility. At the cadet store, the tailors were almost as fast as the barbers. In the wink of an eye, they took all our measurements, made a few adjustments, and handed us a pair of gray flannel trousers, or plebeskins. Next, we were issued a duffel bag. As we carried it down the line in the gymnasium boxing room, it would be filled with a seemingly endless number of items to include uniforms, underwear, socks, belts, toilet articles, pajamas, a bathrobe, t-shirts, shorts, and even suspenders for our socks. Then we were issued a plebe bag containing 45 more items such as stationery, cuffs, collars, T-pins, and brass. Finally, we received a supply of all the cleaning and polishing materials we were to become so familiar with over the next 4 years. Corcoran shoe polish, Noxon, Brasso, Wilson cleaner, a jeweler's rouge cloth, and Linspeed oil. If only they had issued the elbow grease to go with it. We went to our assigned rooms where we met our new roommates and immediately prepared for the swearing-in ceremony, which would begin shortly. Wearing our new plebe skins for the first time, we formed up in company mass formations and marched out of the area down Thayer Road past the huge statue of George Washington and the great marble column that was Battle Monument. After the appropriate VIPs gave their remarks, we raised our right hand and recited the cadet oath. We swore to support the Constitution of the United States, to bear true allegiance to the national government, to defend the sovereignty of the United States above all other allegiances, and to obey the Uniform Code of Military Justice. We were now officially new cadets. That evening, as we dug through the bag of items we had been issued in an effort to get everything put away properly, we discovered two books that would dictate how our lives would be conducted for the next year. 4th Class Customs and Traditions spelled out in excruciating detail how we were to walk, talk, speak, eat, dress, and conduct ourselves at all times. It prescribed where we could go and when, and what our duties were as 4th classmen. The part which most of us probably remember most was the section entitled 4th Class Knowledge, which contained lengthy lists of items that we had to memorize verbatim or be thoroughly conversant with, including the entire contents of the other small book, Bugle Notes. Some of the items we memorized were practical, such as the operations order, the estimate of the situation, the name of the officer in charge, and the nomenclature of the M1 rifle. Others were strictly traditional, such as the days, the definition of leather, and the number of lights in column hall or gallons of water in Lusk Reservoir. Still others, such as Schofield's definition of discipline, Scott's fixed opinion, the battalion orders, and MacArthur's message from the Far East, served the dual purpose of making us learn from historic precedents while developing an ability to retain and recall a large volume of detailed information while under extreme pressure at any given time or place.
All right, pop your chest up. Are you up in your plebe knowledge? I believe so, sir.
How many lights in Cullum Hall?
340 lights, sir.
How many gallons in Lusk Reservoir?
92.2 million gallons, sir, when the water's flowing over the spillway.
What do plebes rank?
Sir, a plebe ranks the superintendent's dog, the commandant's cat, the waiters in the mess hall, and all the admirals in the whole blame Navy.
Mr. Townsend, how is the cow?
Sir, she walks, she talks, she's full of chalk. The lacteal fluid extracted from the female of the bovine species is high.
What are the marches to be played at review today?
Finally, taps was sounded, and we had made it through our first day. Over the next few days, we were issued even more uniforms, including the iconic dress gray with its high collar, tailored torso, and its two signature vertical stripes in the back. Between that uniform and bracing, it's no wonder that we all learned to stand tall with excellent posture. For the next 8 weeks, each day started with reveille from the Hellcats. After breakfast, we were thrown into a dizzying mix of constant activity. It was an endless stream of military instruction, drill and ceremonies, mass athletics, shower formations, clothing drills, and inspections. Learning squad drill was a real challenge to many of us. But not as frustrating as learning the mealtime duties of the coffee corporal, water corporal, or gunner. If we were really lucky, we even got to finish a full meal without hearing, "Too slow, mister, sit up," or, "Pass your plate out, mister." Somehow we managed to squeeze in enough additional time to arrange everything in our rooms according to the very exacting standards spelled out in the Cadet Book of Regulations, commonly known as the Blue Book. Shoes were aligned precisely under the bed in a specified order. Bed sheets were turned down by an exact length, and blankets were pulled so taut a quarter would bounce off it. Toilet articles were displayed in an exact layout on the top shelf of the locker. Underwear and socks were folded for display with 3x5 index cards or sheets of paper inside them so that when they were aligned crisply and precisely, they were all the exact same height and width. Belts, brass, dress coats, and trousers also had their assigned places in our lockers or on the alcove wall. We learned the fine art of spit-shining shoes, some more successfully than others. We learned how to do a dress off and how to polish brass so as to produce no lines or scratches. The inspections seemed endless. The upperclassmen and TAC officers looked at everything and accepted nothing less than perfection. Our rooms, our lockers, our clothing displays, our rifles, and our shoes all had to be kept in perfect condition and dust-free. We were inspected wearing every uniform we had. We were inspected in our rooms, in ranks, and in the field. Slowly, no matter what our standards had been in the past, we began to realize that we were capable of doing better and that West Point would always demand even more from us. During the last 2 weeks of Beast Barracks, we prepared for our final trial, the plebe hike. We started with shorter hikes to places like Bull Hill, then went on to longer distances. Finally, after a few days of living in pup tents, we made the last big 15-mile march back to West Point, which included a hike up the Victor Constant ski slope and down the home stretch along Pipeline Trail. Finally, Beast Barracks was over. It'll be different. At least that's what the first E detail told us when they described the end of Beast Barracks and the transition to the academic year. Perhaps some of us hoped that it meant things would be easier, but as we were to soon realize, it was every bit as difficult as Beast, but in a completely different way. There were many new routines and duties to get used to, such as mail carrier, clothing carrier, trunk room orderly, orderly room orderly, and minute caller.
Sir, there are 5 minutes until assembly for reveille formation. The uniform is short overcoats over dress gray. 5 minutes, sir.
We had to be in ranks 5 minutes before the upperclassmen for every reveille and meal formation. We learned what uniform to wear for each formation by checking the specially marked flags that flew outside the guard room. We were prohibited from using the latrines on the upper floors of the barracks, so we had to go all the way down to the basement or the sinks, even if we lived on the fourth floor. The Beast Barracks shower formations that we hated so much because we had to sweat our shadows on the wall were replaced by something that could sometimes be just as unpleasant. Special inspections, or calls as they were known in cadet slang, required us to report to our squad leader's room before breakfast and dinner as punishment for having received a 4C, a delinquency report for violating any part of the fourth class system. We all dreaded hearing our squad or platoon leader yell, "Drive around to my room on calls tonight, dumb smack." What took place during calls could run the gamut from standing silently in the dark with the shades drawn while the upperclassmen in the room caught just a few more Z's before formation, to an all-out third-degree flaming where we would be chewed up one side and down the other and required to recite just about every bit of plebe poop we had ever learned.
The major traits of leadership are integrity, knowledge, courage, decisiveness, dependability, initiative, tact, justice, enthusiasm, bearing, endurance, and unselfishness.
A common item at calls was a recitation of The Days, an oral newspaper that required us to learn and recite accurately a long list of upcoming events. The Days were supposed to include only the shows for Saturday night and Sunday, varsity athletic events and hops for the week, special programs and the number of days until the Navy game, Christmas leave, 100th night, spring leave, and graduation. Whew. It became commonplace, however, to have to include the menu for the upcoming meal and a variety of personal notes for each upperclassman in the room, such as the number of days until their OAO, their one and only, or steady girlfriend, would come to West Point for a visit, or when they would get their class ring, buy a new car, or whatever else they wished to keep track of. We didn't just stroll to class with books tucked under our arms, chatting with friends. We formed in sections and marched there. Mealtime was a different experience from beast barracks. Now, it was just three plebes and seven upperclassmen, each of them demanding that we know their preferences for any or all of the many different beverages that might be on the table for that next meal.
Sir, the cold beverage for this meal is water. Is there anyone who does not care for water? Sir, the hot beverage for this meal is coffee. Is there anyone who does not care for coffee?
Meat is on the table, sir. Meat for Mr. Riley, sir.
Well, let's hear the days, Mr. Ziegler.
Sir, there are three and a butt days until the weekend. Sir, the movie for Saturday night is White Cloud, starring Miss Laura LaBelle and Mr. Rock Middleton. Sir, there is a hop Saturday.
Desserts had their own rituals, and plebes had to learn how to cut round pies or square cakes into exactly equal size pieces. We found that cutting seven equal pieces of pie or nine equal slices of cake required a keen eye, a good sense of proportion, and a template, which we carried inside our hats. If the dessert was especially good, someone at the table would often yell, "Let's go, Big Dick!" We would then flip our knives and give a thumbs up or a thumbs down. Those in the minority were eliminated, and the routine was repeated until someone won and got the privilege of taking as much of the dessert as he wanted, up to half. On rare occasions, the table commandant might grant a fallout. If we could come up with a clever reason, such as a favorite team winning a sports contest, we would be allowed to eat in a casual manner and talk with our classmates. Some table comms granted fallouts liberally, while others almost never did. In either case, we always envied our classmates who sat on corps squad tables and got to fall out all the time. West Point's Saturdays were quite different from any other college or university. Following reveille and breakfast, we had classes such as physical education and topography. While we were in class, company TAC officers would visit our rooms for a SAMI, short for Saturday AM inspection. Then came lunch formation, followed by a full dress inspection in ranks and a brigade review on the plane. Finally, we were free to meet our families and drags at Grant Hall for an afternoon of walking around the plane or visiting the Hotel Thayer. As plebes, there weren't really many places we could go on a Saturday. We were restricted to the level of the plane and couldn't go to the weapons room or flirtation walk, although we could always climb up to Fort Putnam, high on a hill overlooking most of West Point and the Hudson. Fort Putt was also known as Plebe Flirty, as it was the only place available for plebes to engage in a little PDA, or public display of affection. West Point's academic system was another completely new and different experience. Classes were small, with only 15 men per section, arranged alphabetically at first, then rearranged monthly thereafter, according to academic order of merit in each subject. Under the Thayer system, every cadet recited every day in every subject and received a grade for it. A day's recitation could be a written or oral quiz, a homework assignment, a class discussion, or a formal board presentation. At the command of "take boards," each cadet would go to a section of the blackboard and write out the process he used to derive an answer to either a pre-assigned or a pop problem. At the command, "cease work," everybody's chalk hit the tray. Each cadet would then stand at his board, pointer in hand, and start with, "Sir, I am required to solve." The grading system was different as well. No A's and B's, no 100% max grade and 70% passing, and definitely no skipping class for any reason. The max grade was 3.0. Anything above 2.0 was pro or proficient, 2.0 was tangent, and below that was D or deficient. We soon learned that the keystone of fall activities at West Point was not academics or inspections or parades. It was most definitely Army football. Rallies popped up everywhere. There were mess hall rallies where tables were stacked three high, and a brave plebe seeking a fallout would climb to the top to lead a rocket cheer. There were after taps rallies when the silence and darkness of night was shattered by a voice yelling, "Rally, rally, rally!" And the entire Corps of Cadets exploded into North, Central, and South areas, and the victory wagon magically appeared in Central area as a platform for coaches and players to stand on while leading cheers and pumping up the spirit of the Corps. After taps rallies were absolute chaos, but boy, were they fun. Who can ever forget that first experience of the Army-Navy game? Reveille at 2 a.m., marching to the train station, sleeping in every possible place on the train to Philadelphia, donning uniforms on the train, and forming up beside the tracks for the march on. The thrill of marching into Veterans Stadium to the cheers of 100,000 fans will ring in our ears forever. Then there were the rocket cheers and "pass him up," as a brave plebe was hoisted up on the outstretched arms of the Corps and transported up and then down the entire cadet section for all to see. Finally, the tradition of singing the alma mater at the end of the game and then on to the parties at the Ben Franklin Hotel. What great times they were. Some of the season highlights included seeing the great Jim Brown play for Syracuse and a 60-0 win over Columbia, where we gave a rocket cheer for their retiring coach by replacing "team, team, team" at the end with "Lou Little, Lou Little, Lou Little." It was a joke that stayed with us for many years. When the three upper classes left West Point for the Christmas holidays, we were required to remain at West Point. Plebe Christmas was the first time when we had the entire place to ourselves, with no classes, no bracing, and a lot of fun activities. Many of us invited family and high school sweethearts to stay at the Hotel Thayer. The days were filled with tours of every classroom, department, and building we ever saw. In the evening, there were receptions, hops, parties, and movies to include a showing of the film Making of a West Pointer. A major plebe Christmas event was the Ice Carnival, which featured Carol Heiss, the 1956 World Figure Skating Champion, along with a relay race, broom hockey, and the famous Southern Sweepstakes, where cadets from the South who had never been on skates raced around the rink, most of the time on their rear ends. Christmas leave was followed by gloom period, when the gray skies, gray buildings, gray uniforms were matched by the gray attitudes and demeanor of the cadets who had just returned from leave and were now facing the prospect of intense study to prepare for term-end exams. As plebes, we shared the letdown that followed the freedom of plebe Christmas. We faced a battery of finals known in cadet slang as whoopers, woofers, and woogers, knowing that there were a number of our classmates who would not survive them and would either be turned back to the next class or found and expelled from the academy for academic deficiency. We thought that winter would give us a reprieve from parades. What we didn't know or expect was that there were events known as bandbox reviews that would continue throughout the winter. These regimental-sized parades had all of the pomp and pageantry of those on the plane, including a pass and review, except that they were performed completely within the tight confines of Central Area. If the temperature was reasonable, the uniform was full-dress gray under arms. If it got really cold, it was dress gray under long overcoats under arms. We learned that the manual of arms was much more difficult when wearing an overcoat and winter gloves. The great American public was able to view the ceremonies from the stoops on three sides of the area. Since we were under such close scrutiny from such a short distance, we had to stand like statues, being especially careful to avoid looking around, licking our lips, or showing any expression. Sometimes we wished that spring would come soon, just so that we could get back to the relative comfort of marching on the plain. Once spring arrived, there were only few major events until the end of plebe year. The first was 100th night, when the plebes had the opportunity to swap roles with the upperclassmen for a day and make them brace, recite plebe poop, and do all the other things that they had harassed us with since September. Then, in mid-March, came spring leave, which was a miniature version of plebe Christmas, only shorter and with fewer activities. In the spring, parades had a much lighter tone to them. An upperclassman in the rear rank might say, "Mr. Smith, tell me your best joke." And if you didn't have a good one at the ready, you were in for a hard time on calls that night. The only thing that made it all tolerable was that we knew we were on the final leg of plebe year. At long last, we reached the end of the academic year, finished our final exams, and got ready for what is probably the most hectic week of the year at West Point, June week. In the mess hall, the upperclassmen had us doing such things as eating jam sandwiches, so-called because we had to jam as many slices of bread into our mouths as possible. The hazing sometimes got pretty intense on calls when we were told to climb up on the alcove rail in full dress uniform and swim to Newburgh until our arms felt like they would fall off. Since all June week activities centered around the firsties and plebes just got underfoot, they got rid of us for an entire day by transporting our whole class with drags across the river to Constitution Island for the plebe picnic. Graduation finally came, and not a one of us will ever forget the spectacle we witnessed at graduation parade. The class of 1957 was supposed to march halfway across the plain, shoulder to shoulder, stopping to salute, and then continuing all the way to the reviewing line. Instead, one of them let out a rebel yell after the salute, planted a Confederate flag in the middle of the plain, and led the charge as almost the entire class broke and ran the rest of the way. They received harsh discipline for their action, nearly had their commissions delayed, and were forever known thereafter as Black 57. We marched back into our respective areas and formed up for the thing we had all been working and waiting for, recognition. One by one, every upperclassman in our company walked down each rank and shook our hand. No longer Sir, we could now call him Jim, or Frank. We had arrived. We made it through plebe year and were now yearlings. Yearling year started with a long-anticipated and well-deserved 30-day leave. Leave ended all too quickly, however, and we reported back to Camp Buckner for cadet summer training. This would be our initial opportunity to learn firsthand what our chosen profession was actually like.
Camp Buckner is quite a place. It's about 7 miles from West Point, and it's the hub of yearling summer training. Everything is set up so you learn things by doing them. For example, during armored training, we drove tanks. Believe me, that's an experience I never dreamed could be part of college life. We learn how an infantry squad operates by being in one and running one ourselves. We learned about artillery by actually firing the guns. We took turns manning each station. Of course, you get supervision all the time. Always you're the one doing it. Like making river crossings in assault boats with smoke screens and blank ammunition to give you a sense of the real thing. soon began to understand the fundamentals of tactics. I guess that's the whole idea behind the Camp Buckner program. In addition to the M1 rifle, we learned to fire other infantry weapons. You never sit on the sidelines. You're always in there doing. That's how you learn.
We looked forward to the weekends at Buckner when our drags came up to join us on the beach, sail on Lake Popolopen, attend hops in Barth Hall, and walk with us by the lake along Buckner Flirty. Our time at Buckner also included walking punishment tours on the tennis court, taking the PT test on the tennis court, and conducting in-ranks inspections on the tennis court. Some of us even got to play tennis there. Then there was evening guard duty, walking along dark roads in the woods. Who can forget shouting, "Halt, who goes there?" Only to find that the noise came from a raccoon who had invaded the trash cans near the mess hall. A true highlight of Camp Buckner was the slide for life. Climbing up a 65-foot ladder, gripping onto the hook of an old block-and-tackle pulley, and stepping off the tiny platform for a thrilling ride down a steep cable to a splashdown in the lake is something we'll never forget. Parades continued to be an integral part of our lives, but with a difference that was unique to Camp Buckner. Here, we dressed in India whites and marched in company mass formations rather than in squad drill, and we proved again that we really knew how to march in precision. It all ended with the Buckner Stakes, a 12-station competition that tested everything we had learned during the summer. Then there was Camp Illumination, a combination talent show and carnival that featured the color line show, a hop, and a chance to relax before heading back to West Point. Yearling year was a comparatively calm period in our West Point experience. While still challenging, academics really didn't change very much. Topo became graphics, and we picked up physics and chemistry, but otherwise, math, English, foreign languages, and tactics were pretty much an extension of what we had as plebes, but without having to march to class. There were few duties assigned to yearlings other than cadet in charge of quarters, or CQ, and plebe chaser, whose job it was to ensure that plebes were at meal formations on time, in proper uniform, and bracing. We were quick to take advantage of the places that had previously been off limits to us, such as Flirtation Walk, the Weapons Room, the Grant Hall Boodlers, and, of course, the latrines on the upper floors of barracks. We were also happy to leave the place to the new plebes during Christmas and spring leave. A big highlight of the football season was an article by sports writer Dick Young of the New York News, who called classmate Bob Anderson the best running sophomore in the nation. Bob was named a consensus All-American and came in seventh in voting for the Heisman Trophy. Gloom period came and went again. Spring arrived, and we look forward to our second graduation parade. We had started yearling year with the Army coming to Camp Buckner to train us, but cow year began in just the opposite way. It was our turn to go out and see the Army on its home turf to learn firsthand how it trained and how it lived and how junior officers interacted with the men under their command. Right after the 1958 graduation, our entire class loaded its overstuffed B-4 bags onto buses and headed for Fort Monmouth, New Jersey, the home of the Signal Corps. For the next 2 days, we received briefings, orientations, and hands-on training in everything from radar, microwaves, and cryptography to aerial photography and wirelane. In the evening, we donned our India White uniforms again to impress the ladies at a hop, and were even serenaded by our own class's glee club members. We bussed to Aberdeen Proving Ground for lunch, then on to Fort Belvoir, Virginia, home of the Corps of Engineers, in time for another hop. Once the social obligations were out of the way, we observed 2 days of demonstrations on the various pieces of engineer equipment used for construction and demolition, and saw the newest engineer developments that support combat operations. Next, after several changes of aircraft, we boarded C-130s for the trip from Andrews Air Force Base to Fort Rucker, Alabama, to learn about Army aviation. We received ground training, piloted Link trainers, and even got to fly Sioux helicopters and L-19 observation planes. Back on the buses, our next stop was Fort Benning, Georgia, home of the infantry. Following the first evening's obligatory hop and reception, we spent 5 days participating in live fire exercises, tactical maneuvers, and demonstrations. The Ranger Department showed us how to rappel down a mountainside, performed an unarmed combat demonstration, and showed what it was like to go down the big slide for life. The Airborne Department put us through a mini jump school to include jumping out of the 34-foot towers to become trolley troopers. Our next leg took us to Norfolk Naval Air Station, Virginia, where we toured several naval vessels and learned about the role of Navy air. After sitting in the pouring rain to watch a Marine amphibious assault landing, we flew to the carrier USS Tarawa by helicopter for an overnight cruise to New York City. What a wonderful sight to see the Statue of Liberty as we entered the harbor. After the trip, our class was split in two. Half of us went on summer leave, while others were assigned to Army Orientation Training, or AOT, at either Fort Bragg with the 82nd Airborne Division, Fort Campbell with the 101st Airborne Division, or Fort Benning with the 2nd Infantry Division. Under the watchful eye of junior officers, we acted as platoon leaders and instructors while getting an even closer look at what our futures would be by experiencing the social side of Army life. Still others were assigned as cadet corporals to the Beast Barracks detail at West Point and got to see that it was not necessarily easier to go through Beast simply because you didn't have to brace. Cow year was a lot more intense than yearling year. The academics ramped up considerably as yearling math, English, physics, chemistry, and graphics were replaced by the higher intensity courses such as mechanics of fluids, mechanics of solids, electrical engineering, and social science. The fluids and solids courses that were taught to engineering majors at other schools in a year were crammed down our throat in a single semester. Sleep was something that we only imagined we needed. Little did we know then that one of our instructors, Air Force Captain Frank Borman, would one day fly to the moon and back. Some of us were given the privilege of wearing corporal stripes and were assigned additional responsibilities. Cow year was not without some very enjoyable events that compensated for the heavier workload and responsibilities, however. That began right away in September, when a contingent of classmates was selected to go to Atlantic City to act as escorts for the Miss America pageant. Well, someone had to do it. We spent more time dragging and spending Saturday evenings at the weapons room, and we even got 1 weekend leave per semester, which many of us spent getting acquainted with the sights and sounds of New York City. The biggest and best part of the fall season, however, was Army football. What a year! The season opened with the nation's first look at the Lonesome End, a strategy that would revolutionize football forever, featuring our All-American classmate, Bill Carpenter. Army began a winning streak that would include a 14-2 win over Notre Dame, their first since 1945, at South Bend. Who can forget the excitement back at West Point when the entire Corps spilled out of the barracks and raced across the plain to Trophy Point with the victory wagon in tow to celebrate the win? The streak continued, except for Pittsburgh, which ended in a 14-14 tie. One of the most exciting games of the year was against Rice. The Corps watched it in the Thayer Hall Auditorium on a special closed-circuit TV hookup from Houston. With the game tied at 7-7 and less than a minute to go, just as Pete Dawkins caught a pass on the 10-yard line and stumbled, the screen went black. There was silence, and then pandemonium as someone with a transistor radio yelled, "He scored!" The buildup to the Army-Navy game was tremendous that year. Mess hall rallies were louder and longer than others, and the aftertaps rally before the game was perhaps the biggest one ever, including a bonfire and hauling the victory wagon all the way up the hill to Coach Blake's quarters, where he made a rare rally appearance. Army went on to beat Navy 22-6 and finished the season undefeated for the first time since 1949. After a well-deserved Christmas leave and gloom period, we got to spend some time in the world's largest dormitory, Bancroft Hall, during the Army-Navy exchange weekend, and we got firsthand confirmation that West Point really was the best service academy of all in more ways than one. We certainly all weren't angels, and by this time, some of us had accumulated a significant number of hours walking the area, doing punishment tours for having exceeded demerit limits or committing a significant breach of regulations. Some of us walked as many as 100 hours and became members of the infamous Century Club. In April, the entire Corps headed to New York City to again participate in the annual Armed Forces Day Parade. We all swelled with pride to march down Fifth Avenue to the applause of thousands and thousands of people who turned out to show their support for our military. June week finally arrived, and we all looked forward to the new and exciting leadership opportunities that awaited us during the coming year as first classmen. First class year began much like cow year with summer trips to Army posts. At Fort Knox and Fort Sill, we saw weapons, tactical demonstrations, and the mandatory Mad Minute, where it seemed as if all of the spare ammunition on post was fired simultaneously at a single target. The only thing that was actually much different were the Buffalo Burgers at Fort Sill. Following the trip, we were assigned to leadership cadres for Beast Barracks, Camp Buckner, or Army Basic Training at Fort Hood, Texas. This time, we were finally placed in actual leadership positions and were given the responsibility and authority to make real-time decisions and to be the primary trainers and leaders. Back at West Point, our final year would be filled with one important event after another that would make it a busy, challenging, and rewarding year. We started off finding ourselves in charge of almost everything that affected our daily lives, from leading the chain of command itself, captains of athletic teams, and chairman of the many clubs and activities available to the Corps of Cadets. The first major event in September was Ring Weekend, when we received our class rings. These were a symbol that would forever link us to the long gray line. We celebrated at the Ring Hop, which was the first formal social event of the year. Football season opened with a huge 44-8 victory over Boston College, followed by our class football trip to Champaign-Urbana, Illinois. Despite our most enthusiastic aftertaps rallies, however, a repeat of the 58 season was not to be, as Army finished 4-4-1, including a loss to Navy. Besides football and our increasingly expanded off-post privileges, our weekends were occupied with vendor displays of the latest in stylish civilian clothing, featuring narrow lapel jackets and Sinatra-style pork pie hats, and the most important weekend display of all, the car show. We got to peek under the hood and kick the tires of everything from sedans to sports cars. We saw our first T-Birds and Corvettes, but in the end, most of us chose white Chevys. A lot more of the drags could be seen wearing A-pins or even miniatures of our West Point rings as their engagement rings. For those lucky enough to have OAOs who lived near West Point, a lot of time was spent in the weapons room, dancing to what we now call oldies. Those who were still stag still found it to be a good place to just get away from the mess hall and enjoy a hamburger and a shake. Everything seemed to accelerate even more after Christmas leave, and academics seemed to be a bit more on the practical and useful side with subjects such as law, ordnance, military art and engineering, and military hygiene. Some of us began to look more seriously at our future, and we were besieged by banks, insurance companies, and military associations wanting us to affiliate with them. Slowly but surely, we were emerging from the cocoon of cadet life and were being exposed to the real world. Around the 1st of February, we went to military uniform displays where we were fitted for our first Army uniforms and Maury Luxenburg hats, and all the insignia and extras that went with them. Becoming an officer was starting to drain our fixed account. The end of February brought the 100th night show, Finders Keepers. Classmates played all of these parts, and the whole Corps got to see exactly who could and couldn't sing, dance, and act. We looked forward with great anticipation to the end of March and the announcement of branch selections and the list of Airborne and Ranger School attendees. We were pleased to learn that nearly everyone got their first choice and that 95% of those qualified to attend Ranger and or Airborne had selected both. Once we finished our last social science monograph and our last written general review, June week arrived. It was an absolute sprint to the finish line. There were parades, dragging, plebe hazing, packing, hops, receptions, concerts, baccalaureate, graduation parade, recognition ceremony, graduation hop, and finally, graduation itself.
At West Point, 551 cadets become lieutenants. Getting diplomas in order of rank, the first to receive his is the top man, Charles Ottstadt of Dallas, Texas. Both military and academic merit are taken into consideration in determining the class rankings. Most of the cadets naturally are going into the Army, but a few join the Air Force and Marines. Thomas Throckmorton receives his diploma from his father, General Throckmorton, as does Thomas Happer Taylor, whose father is former Army Chief of Staff, Maxwell Taylor. Top and bottom men shake hands. They're both from Texas. Anchorman Charles Herbert Wood Jr. of San Antonio gets the biggest ovation of all. And is he ever happy to get his diploma?
The class of 1960 was a true watershed class in terms of the history of West Point. We did not realize at the time that we were to be the last class admitted to West Point on the basis of College Board scores alone, before the concept of the whole man score was adopted, which included evaluation of leadership and athletic skills. Nor did we have any idea that we would be the last class to be assigned to companies strictly by height, and that parades would never be the same after that went away. We thought that all classes had mottos, but did not learn until later that we were the very first class since 1881 to adopt an official class motto. Go Like 60 had a special ring to it. It was mission, motivation, and manner all rolled up into one short exclamation. The classes of 59 and 58 later came up with their own slogans, but they never adopted an official class motto. Since then, however, class mottos have become embedded as a strong tradition for all West Point classes, and it all began with Go Like 60. Academically, we were the first class to depart from the traditional, single, fixed curriculum when the first academic section was allowed to take a single elective course during first class year. This would be the very first small step in a series of sweeping academic changes that would be implemented over the next several decades. During COW summer, we were the first class to have COW corporals assigned to the Beast Barracks detail, and the first to be sent to various Army posts to participate in Army Orientation, or AOT, which placed us in the role of junior officers with various training and operational duties with the regular Army. As part of the Academy's physical transformation, we were one of the last classes to both study in the old library as yearlings and attend classes in the new Thayer Hall Academic Building as COWs. We were also the first class to be issued old Army brown combat boots which were immediately dyed black during Beast Barracks in preparation for the new Army uniforms of the future, and we were the last class to be led and taught by officers who wore pinks and greens when we started plebe year, only to change to the new Army green uniform in our yearling year. Yes, we were truly the class of change at West Point. Without question, the period from July 3, 1956 to June 8, 1960 was a period that shaped all of our lives. It helped to form and cement the qualities, attributes, and values that would carry us through the rest of our lives. It taught us how to be officers and gentlemen, and it instilled in us a strong sense of duty, honor, and country that would forever guide our steps along the path of the harder right over the easier wrong. Statistically, this period produced a group of 550 close-knit friends who would go on to achieve success in a variety of fields. While one out of four left active duty within 5 years, 60% of the class served a full military career and retired with 20 or more years of service, with 146 of our number reaching the rank of colonel or higher. We proved our mettle in Vietnam, where 357 of us served, and we went on to the Sound of the Guns, where we earned a total of 80 Purple Hearts, 225 awards for valor, all the way up to the Distinguished Service Cross. Those who worked in the civilian sector, either in lieu of or after a military career, also excelled and reached the highest levels of their chosen professions. More than 125 were CEOs or highly placed executives, while 20% struck out on their own as entrepreneurs. Our class made significant contributions and achieved success in a variety of fields, including law, medicine, engineering, education, manufacturing, and many, many more. Above all else, however, we have maintained those affiliations, memories, and friendships that began 64 years ago on the plane at West Point. These are the things that we cherish and that we will keep close to our hearts always. Go like 60.